In the past year, the story that most cosmologists tell about the history of the universe has begun to crumble under the impact of a flood of data and images from the James Webb Space Telescope, the JWST. Right now, the hypothesis that the universe began 14 billion years ago in a huge explosion and has been expanding ever since is contradicted by at least a dozen separate sets of scientific evidence. From any scientific viewpoint, this hypothesis has been invalidated. But if the Big Bang never happened, what did? Is there an alternative history of cosmic evolution that is scientifically validated? And what does it matter in the here and now what happened in galaxies far away, billions or even trillions of years ago? In this new video series, we're going to be discussing the real story of cosmic evolution, what really happened in the history of the universe, and how it connects to the here and now. Because what we'll find is, again and again, the processes that we need to understand to comprehend the evolution of the cosmos can be applied here on Earth, in particular, in the development of fusion energy. Cheap, clean, safe, and unlimited energy. In fact, an alternative history of cosmic evolution has been developed over the last 50 years, starting with the work of physics Nobel laureate Hannes Alfvén and his collaborators. This is a story that is based on scientifically validated predictions, confirmed by subsequent observations, and is based on processes that we can see and study here on Earth and in the solar system. It doesn't need any mysterious entities like dark energy or dark matter or inflation. I've termed this story of cosmic evolution plasma cosmology because the phenomena of plasmas, electrically conducting gases, are central to studying cosmic evolution. Now, to study the evolution of the cosmos, or the evolution of anything, a correct scientific method is essential. As Alfvén wrote 40 years ago, to try to write a grand cosmical drama leads necessarily to myth. To try to let knowledge substitute ignorance in increasingly large regions of space and time is science. In other words, if we want to learn about the real universe, we can't sit at our computers and write the most beautiful equations that describes how the universe must have started. This leads to myth in the language of mathematics. And it's possible to write myths in the language of mathematics just as easily as it is in the language of Sumerian or Hebrew or English. If we want real science, we have to start with observations and step by step work our way outwards in space and backwards in time. So we're always describing a story that does not have a beginning. We're always describing a story that starts as far back in time as we can see with our present technology and our present knowledge of science. Second, a correct understanding of cosmic evolution must include the understanding that the universe is not just made up of structures, of things like protons and atoms and molecules, but also consists of the processes that maintain the existence of such structures. The bottom-up philosophical approach called reductionism that says the universe is just consists of elementary particles that are built up into nuclei, that are built up into atoms, that are built up into molecules, and so on, leads to paradoxes and mysteries when it's applied to complex processes. and the evolution of the universe is as complex as they get. Instead, you have to look at the processes, such as thermonuclear fusion in stars, that gives rise to these structures, such as the chemical elements. To understand this distinction better, think of what happens when you take a breath. When you breathe in, oxygen molecules in the atmosphere go into your lungs, are transferred into your bloodstream, and within seconds enter your cells and become part of you. Now, we can obviously see that oxygen molecules in the atmosphere are not alive. But did they suddenly come to life when they entered your cells? And when you breathe out the carbon dioxide that those oxygen molecules eventually become, do those molecules then die? Well, if we're only looking at the structures, this process seems very paradoxical. But if we understand it as processes, it makes sense. The oxygen molecules entering your body become part of the process of life that sustains you. And you, as an individual human being, are part of a greater process of life. The process of life that gave rise to you as an individual, to our species, the entire process of biological evolution that sustains all life on Earth. To understand how an oxygen molecule operates as part of that process, we have to understand the process itself. Now, these processes can be studied with the same mathematical precision that structures like atoms and molecules can be studied with. But that study is essential to describing the greatest process of them all, which is cosmic evolution. What is the furthest back in time that we now have evidence for? The observations that give us the furthest view back are those of the largest scale structures in the universe. As space-based and ground-based telescopes have peered further and further out into space, they've discovered larger and larger conglomerations of galaxies. Roughly spherical clusters of galaxies are strung like beads on filaments stretching over tens of millions of light years. And these filaments are twisted into a hierarchy of larger and larger superclusters, extending upwards to 4 billion light years in radius, and even larger in length. We can estimate how long it took to form these structures because we know how fast objects are moving within them. It takes a structure to form at least as long as it takes a structure to move around its axis in one revolution. So we can determine from the velocities that these objects are moving at, and from their size, then it must have taken 7 or 8 trillion years to form these objects, because the objects within them are only moving at about 1/300th the speed of light. Now, of course, 7 or 8 trillion years is about 500 times as long as the hypothetical time since the Big Bang. So the very existence of these large objects is one of the biggest pieces of evidence, literally biggest, against the Big Bang hypothesis. Without the time limitation imposed by the Big Bang hypothesis, it's possible to understand the production of these large-scale structures. Starting in 1978, Alfvén and his collaborators developed theories based on processes that we observe in the laboratory that explain how such large structures could have come into existence. The first of these processes is the pinch effect. That's the attraction of electric currents moving in the same direction caused by the interaction of the currents with the magnetic fields that the currents themselves produce. There's an effect first observed using currents and wires by Ampere back in 1820. In a plasma in space with some electrons moving freely, the pinch effect acts to draw plasma together into swirling vortex whirlwinds or filaments. These filaments form because any tiny currents of electrons moving in one direction will attract other currents that happen to be moving in the same direction. They repel currents moving in the opposite direction. Over time, larger and larger electrical currents build up, creating a hierarchy of filaments. We observe such filaments today at all scales in the universe, as beautifully seen in the images of the Veil Nebula. Over immense periods of time, tiny currents of a few kiloamps gradually merge together into gigantic filaments, millions and then billions of light years in radius, carrying close to a sextillion amps. Out of these filaments, the largest structures that we now observe have formed. Well, how do we know that these gigantic filaments formed in this way? How do we know this is not just another fairy tale like the Big Bang? Well, first of all, this theory is based on physical processes and theories that we have studied for centuries in the laboratory and that we can use to control technology. The basic theory controlling the motion of plasmas is Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. And Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism underlies most of our technology today. If you want to see whether Maxwell's theory is correct, just turn on the nearest light, because the energy that supplies that light bulb is only generated through the application of Maxwell's theories. This is very unlike the situation, for example, with dark energy, where there is no evidence for this in the laboratory and no rigorous theory. Second, we can observe and manipulate the filaments themselves in laboratory experiments. As we'll explain in more detail in the subsequent parts of this series, filaments appear spontaneously in all high-energy plasmas that are used to produce fusion here on Earth. In our own dense plasma focus machine, we use the filaments as the first stage of a process of concentrating plasma and heating it. Third, and perhaps most significantly, we observe at all scales in the universe that magnetic fields characteristic of these filaments do exist. Magnetic fields can be detected remotely by their effects on the polarization of light and radio waves. Polarization refers to the direction that the electric and magnetic fields oscillate in electromagnetic radiation, such as light and radio waves. Detailed comparisons of the structure and magnitude of the magnetic fields have confirmed the quantitative predictions of the theory that these filaments are guided by electric and magnetic forces. We'll discuss more evidence for this process in subsequent parts of this series as we discuss how electromagnetism and gravitation interact to form the hierarchy of structure that we see in the universe today, going from stars to galaxies to clusters of galaxies to superclusters. LPPFusion's researchers are not backed by billionaires. Our work, both in fusion and in astrophysics, are supported by thousands of individual investors. Unfortunately, that's just not enough. To hire the people we need to achieve maximum speed in our research, we need another $1 million a year. You can provide that. Not by yourself, to be sure. But we have 12,000 subscribers to LPPFusion's YouTube channel. If just each of you donated $10 a month to LPPFusion, that's only 3 dimes a day, or you invested in LPPFusion, $100 a year, we would get another $1.2 million per year. Our work can provide energy that is 90% cheaper than any available today. Safe, clean, unlimited, no greenhouse gases, no pollution, decentralized energy, a better future for all of us. So, thanks for your support.